rather.
That's the spinal column that you can see in the fork of the tree, so she's probably not going to be able to get too much more meat off there. But we've been incredibly fortunate in that she has been in the same area for such a long period of time. And the whole year that I've been here at Juma, I've never seen her on a kill for this long, and that's for a number of reasons. We haven't seen her making big kills very recently, so it may have just been that we were in the wrong spot at the wrong time, and she's been making smaller kills that we've seen that are a lot easier for her to finish off in a short space of time. Also, when we, or at least when I arrived here in November last year, she had two young male, or kind of young males, who are her cubs, who were mature, reaching maturity, and they were stealing a lot of her kills. And if she did kill something big like an impala, they would often find it and help her finish it off. Now she doesn't have that problem. This is the spinal cord I was talking about. This is also in all likelihood going to drop down to the ground shortly, and there will be some animals waiting. Two hyena have just come back onto the scene. I'm guessing they're the same two hyena from earlier on. The one in the front certainly looks like it, and the one in the back. And it was a wonderful display of hyena hierarchy as that other hyena came charging in with no concern at all. Now what would have happened is that other hyena in this area would have heard that commotion, and we may even find that more hyena will start approaching. So I'm just beginning to scan 360 degrees around us just to make sure we're not missing out on anything. It's a crisp, cool morning here, 17 degrees Celsius, about 66 degrees Fahrenheit. Not a breath of wind. And you got a glimpse of that magnificent sunrise earlier. There don't seem to be too many clouds in the sky. So we're in for a good day out on safari. We've just touched on a little bit of the hyena hierarchy, and that it's complex, but definite hierarchy exists within clans of hyena. And Mischen in Texas has very wisely pointed out that the smaller hyena that we saw initially, that was feeding on the scraps of the impala, must be more dominant than the other individual that was bigger than it, but kind of standing off in the distance, not wanting to even think about stealing any of the kill. And even though it's a lot bigger than the individual that was feeding, the hierarchy obviously protected that smaller individual, which may have had kind of royal genes, you could say, may have been born into alpha status simply by having the right parents. I guess not hugely dissimilar to us as humans, various royal families around the world. And this hyena coming back in is the one that we think is part of the Juma hyena royal family. That's why it managed to command a little bit of respect. But the other individual that came running through certainly must have been higher ranking, or at least more powerful and bold. Very difficult for us to know exactly what goes on in their lives. There we can see a good size comparison. I mean, the one on the right is considerably larger and also looks to be older than the one on the left. I don't know what you guys think. Let's compare their head sizes. Now, don't be fooled by the appendage between the back legs of the smaller hyena. It could still be a female. They've got incredibly similar looking appendages. The females greatly enlarged clitoris takes on the resemblance of a penis. And this is what makes these animals incredibly difficult for us to understand completely. Oh, another little scrap. Phenomenal that this other hyena, even while this individual was further away, the hyena in the background now didn't come too close. It didn't look around for any scraps. So hard to know exactly, like I say, what's going on and why. But wonderful behavior nonetheless. Look at her lips. She's got a serious grimace going on there. It's looking up at Karula in the tree there. You saw its kind of forehead crinkled up there as it was bending its head up to possibly try and beg Karula to drop some more meat down for them. It will happen, so we're not gonna go anywhere. There's that portion of the spine and the skull that is bound to come down very shortly. Karula's now doing her best to actually lick the meat off the bone. And lions and leopards will do that. They've got a rough tongue that kind of resembles sandpaper, I guess, and it helps to lick off flesh so as to not waste anything. As we take a closer look now, you'll see her doing quite a lot of licking, more licking than chewing. Something's about to drop. Hello, Tammy in Washington. And Tammy seems to think that the hyena ran off with the fetus of the impala. Not a bad guess. It did certainly resemble the fetus of the unborn lamb. But I did actually see Karula finishing that off, not last night, but the night before. And what I'll try and do is, I'm actually not entirely sure if it's completely finished, and there was one little leg of that impala lamb up in an apple leaf tree. We had a remarkable sighting, Tammy, of her up in an apple leaf tree. She had been chased up. Oh, here it goes. Crazy stuff. The hyena was certainly a lot more bold this time around. That's the skull. You can see the jawbone at the bottom there sticking out. So now all that remains, I think, is a little piece of the spine. Unless that's in the mouth of the hyena, I think that could be in the mouth of the hyena, unless it missed a portion of the carcass, it may still be at the base of the tree. Just gonna chat with Peter quickly. He's just headed out on drive. Not to worry. Brent's giving the update to him. Well, running off in the same direction as the previous hyena. There's the beautiful sunrise again. And Karula is now grooming herself. I'm not too sure what to do, whether to follow the hyena or stay with the leopard. I think we're going to stay with the leopard, and we've got good news. I'm going to ask Wium just to quickly pan across. I think we're going to have a beautiful shot of the hyena ahead of us. Even though it's a bit of a way off with that rising sun in the background and the hyena feeding, I think we're going to get some great, great light on that shot. Just going to call Peter into the sighting. Ah, there goes the bushwalk team. Sadly, they're having trouble with their backpack that transmits the signal. So I think they're going to be trying to get that sorted out. Sure. Well, it really is wonderful when we get to share such wonderful experiences with our viewers. And this is what safari is all about, everyone. Magical memories. It's not always like this if it's the first time you are joining. We are setting the bar very, very high for you, because this level of interaction between prime carnivores, hyenas, oh, looks like the leopard's moving around here. She could be thinking of coming down the tree. Yeah, there she comes. Now, which way is she going to jump? It's always hard to tell. Up the other side. Okay, I'm just going to move quickly. VMC going up and down this tree a number of times, whereas I haven't. And it seems like this is going to be the better side to be on. Here comes Peter as well, so you might share his vehicle. Look at this. I mean, just the fact that we're getting to look at this leopard while she is up in a tree like this, with a strong chance of her probably jumping down for us, is something that many people may go a whole life of being on safari and never see. Such awesome stuff. Here she goes. Okay, be ready to take screenshots, everyone. It's going to be very quick as she jumps out. I'm readying myself. There she goes. Wow, again, I can't believe our fortune. She's just behind our vehicle. She's probably going to pop out around to the left of Wium now. And it's going to be very interesting to see where she heads from here. Interestingly, it looks like she could be heading towards the apple leaf tree, where there's a tiny portion of the baby impala remaining. It'll be wonderful to see her go up that tree. Mauricia in Texas. And Mauricia is now interested to know, now that she's been feeding on this impala since Sunday night, a long time and a lot of meat to gorge herself on, when will she go off hunting and find her next meal? It could happen within the next half an hour or hour, Mauricia. It all depends on luck, really. I'm just going to loop ahead of her now. Because if an opportunity presents itself to her, she's going to take it. She's not going to say, oh, I'm full now, I'm not that hungry. She's certainly going to do everything in her power to make another kill. And it's not uncommon for leopards to even have two kills simultaneously hoisted up into different trees. Because, like now, she may be feeding on a kill for a period of 5 days. And during that 5-day period, through absolute luck and default, an unlucky prey animal may stumble upon her and give her an easy opportunity to catch another meal, and they will take those opportunities. So difficult to be certain, but what I will tell you is that she will easily, very easily, be able to survive without a meal for 3 days and possibly even longer, possibly even 5 or 6 days before she has her next meal. Obviously, the closer she gets to kind of the 3-day mark, the more likely it is that she will be inclined to go off hunting and look for another meal. But there are no guarantees, Archer, what will happen. I think she might be going to... Yeah, think she's going to try and get a little scrap in this apple leaf tree. Get ready again to take screenshots. She's about to go up this tree. She's looking into it, and this is remarkable. The little apple leaf, or sorry, is in the fork of this tree is where the little impala's leg is, and I'm interested to see if she's not actually going to go up here just for that tiny little morsel. I'm almost certain she is. She's headed straight here as she came down from the jackalberry tree where she's just finished off feeding on the mother of this impala fetus. Oh yeah, she's definitely going to go up. This is going to be great. It's about 6 meters, maybe not that much, maybe 5, maybe 6 meters up to that first fork in the tree. And that is where a tiny little portion, it's kind of the front quarters, I think, of the impala lamb. There you can have a slightly closer look at it. So she's got a little pantry here. I'm hugely surprised that she decided to actually hoist that impala lamb up into this specific tree, because, oh, is your belly too full to climb up now? Fair enough. Now, she was feeding on the impala carcass when we arrived about half an hour before you guys joined us on safari, so she's been stuck up in that tree for quite some time, doing a lot of feeding, and now it's time for her just to take a breather, do some grooming. She's in no rush. Her kills, well, that tiny little portion of the kill is safe up in the tree there. And I think she's just done all the calculations and worked out that she may as well enjoy this beautiful morning rather than getting too worked up like the hyena were. Always happy to know that other people are enjoying the sighting with us, and Peter and some of the other guests with them are there, as well as Jamie. So we are creating some great memories here, not only between us, but between some other safari vehicles. Now, I mentioned that the bushwalk that you saw drive past the hyena running off with the carcass are having some technical difficulties, as well as Brent in the other vehicle. But that's not a problem, because it seems like we are in pole position here so far. So you'll just be stuck with me for the time being. But I think we could certainly be stuck in worse scenarios than this. Peter actually asked me last night if I thought Karula would still be here this morning, and I said no. I think the odds are that she would have finished the kill in the night and be gone. So I'm fortunate that my guess was entirely wrong. Oh, well, there's some great news that's already come through. James and the other vehicle are up and functioning, and he would like to say good morning to you. We'll be staying here with Karula, waiting for your return.
Good morning, everybody. A quick good morning from me, James, and Tebs on camera. We are heading along the Bufasuk cut line looking for tracks of the Nkuhuma Pride, who were found just north of us yesterday evening. We were lucky enough to be there with Peter, and including Junior. And he looks to be in fine fettle, and looking, he was looking for his mother. They weren't separated at the time, but I'm hoping we might see them here. Also, of course, gorgeous morning for finding baby impalas. Brent found the first one yesterday. So while I'm doing that, you continue the magnificent start to your morning that you've had with Scott and Karula, and I will hopefully see you later with some good news. Tally ho!
Beautiful scenes here in the quarantine clearings. There's a bit of a mist and haze in the air, creating for some quite moody scenes. Also, very pretty cloud formations up in the sky. And As VM zooms in on this vehicle, a lot of you will see a familiar face and somebody who has taken a lot of you on many safaris, Mr. Peter Pretorius. He's here enjoying not being behind the camera for now and taking some great pics of Karula, a leopard that he has spent a lot of time with over his years here in the Sabi Sands, specifically at Juma. Wonderful. She did just have another brief look up into the tree, so who knows what she's thinking. Judging by her belly and the state that she's panting, I don't think she's going to go up anytime soon. But who knows, maybe she'll prove us wrong. There she goes, looking up again. And while we wait for her to make up her mind, a question through from Siberia Zumi. And I would like to know if I think leopards have the ability of distinguishing between different individuals and getting to know us or various guides over the years that do spend a lot of time with them. It's a tricky question. I think that they certainly can distinguish between certain vehicles and quite possibly certain individuals, but I've never ever seen huge differences in behavior from one leopard to one human. Oh, I just heard a hyena cackle behind us. What I think I'm actually going to do is just go back to the kill where, or the tree where Karula did have the kill. I did hear some hyena audio there. I can't see them, but it might be worth taking a closer look. She seems quite sleepy. And, oh. Sorry, Siberia, back to your question. I do think it is possible, but like I said, I've never seen any remarkable interactions where any leopard will come up to any certain vehicle or be more relaxed than any specific vehicle. So the hyena have heard the commotion, and I think these could well be actually the same three that we've been seeing all along that have now come back to just make sure there's no scraps lying around. Glorious morning sunshine on them. Look at these two. They seem very happy with one another. Ah, the sun shines wonderful. There's our fireside chat spot and our safari tent, which we're going to be using for the Big Cat Week, which will be airing on Nat Geo Wild in America. So, thanks very much for your observations, Georgianne and Elaine. You guys have noticed that the female at the in the middle there, kind of at the back of these two, her nipples seem to be very enlarged. And is she possibly pregnant? Well, she could well be. They do nurse their young for very long periods of time, so even a female that has given birth and may not be pregnant will still have large nipples. And looking at her, I think I recognize her. She's got a scar on her back. And I think that indicates to me that she is the mother of the youngest hyena cub at the den where we used to spend some time. My memory may be playing tricks on me, but I'm fairly certain the mother of the youngest cub had a very prominent scar on her back. Now, I know a lot of you will be able to probably confirm that for me. Look at them tails curled up, a sign of dominance. Those two definitely standing together, the youngster acting as submissively as possible. But those two adults are not taking any of its nonsense. Look at this. It too now curling up its tail, but not in an aggressive manner towards those adults. You can definitely see that it's acting almost sheepishly when it confronts them.
Why don't you three call for us? Come on.
Nothing better than hyenas singing early in the morning. Just going to reposition ever so slightly. Peter, thanks. Confirm she's heading southwest away from there. Okay, copy. Thank you.
Apologies, everyone. I was just having a quick word with Peter. And it sounds like four more hyena arrived where she was. So a total of seven hyena running around this area at the moment.
So she's moved off. She didn't go up the tree, thankfully. That would have been terrible if we had missed that. But she has started moving off. So let's go and stay with her and see where she goes next. Three hyena have now come back to the scene of the action, established that there's no more easy opportunities, and now they're heading back probably towards their den. We've got a feeling that they have moved back to a den site that we know they have used in the past, but there's no confirmation of that just yet. But we're hoping that in the coming few days we will be able to work out exactly where they are. Carol's just pointed out a good point, and she said, can't we follow the hyena in order to get to their den? And yes, we certainly could, but that would mean leaving Karula. So it's not an easy decision for me to make, Carol. If there was two of me, I would definitely split up and one of me go with the hyena and the other one go with the leopard. James is of James. I think James has been lurking around this general area. I've actually now just got confirmation from Tara, Carol, that James was at the hyena den a little bit earlier this morning, but due to a shaky signal there, we couldn't get you across. So it is actually confirmed James has found the hyena den, and therefore we won't need to actually follow them back. And after we've enjoyed a sight in Karula, maybe I'll take you guys across there, because the signal in this vehicle should be good. So problem solved, and at least we've got a plan for once we've left Karula. Looks like she may have just laid down, and she's not going to be on the move, and she is going to be lying down and relaxing. I think it may be our best bet to race after those hyena and see what's going on there. Never easy to know what to do on safari, especially when there's so much action. To Tara in Ontario, Canada, and after all this hyena action, Tara's interested to know a little bit more about how long will hyena be willing to wait patiently around a tree where a leopard may have her kill hoisted or his kill hoisted, because it didn't seem like the payoff was that great. They didn't get a huge amount of carcass to feed on,
And you're right, Tyra, this time around they didn't get the most food I've ever seen hyena get lucky with, but sometimes leopard can drop an entire carcass out of a fork of a tree, or a large portion of it. And I've seen many different signs of behavior from hyena. Sometimes they will wait patiently without leaving the base of a kill for many, many hours, if not even days. And on other scenarios and other circumstances, hyena will come and go from kill sites, almost monitoring the kill to a point where they'll know when it starts making sense for them to invest more time there. On the initial parts of a kill, when it's unlikely the leopard is going to drop off any small bits of bone or skin, typically the hyena won't invest too much time. But other times, they will, like I said, come and go. Well, as we sit here waiting for her to make her next move, I've got some great news. Brent is out on bushwalk, so tighten your bootlaces and enjoy the adventure that he's got lined up for you.
Good morning and welcome on the Sunrise Walking Safari. So we've walked into this area between where to access. And he called Steph because he'd seen a makuru nyoka, which means a big snake. So it is one of the snakes that doesn't move around too much because he has not moved at all. If we have a look here, it is one of the more venomous snakes we encounter. There we go. It is a puff adder. And those in North America will recognize the shape of the snake, and it sort of look, it does look a little bit like a rattler. The same family, rattlesnakes are adders. You can see that sort of almost diamond or triangular shaped head. Incredibly, incredibly powerful. That whole snake is just muscles. This is a nice big one, and it's probably been feeding off all the frogs that were eating the flying ants last night. So nice and full. And their defensive mechanism, firstly, is their camouflage. And you can see it is wonderful, wonderful camouflage that they have there. So they don't like to move too much. And even when you're walking through the bush, they generally try to warn you before you stand on them with a really loud hiss or a puff, where it gets its name from. A lot of people do get bitten by them in rural Africa by standing on them in long grass. They have cytotoxic venom, an incredibly long, hypodermic needle-like teeth. Well, we're going to jump across to Scott quickly while Karula's mobile, and we'll be standing by here to tell you a little bit more about the snake.
Well done to Brent. And puff adders are such wonderful snakes that we seldomly see. And I'm incredibly jealous of you guys. We did want to get you back here just to say goodbye to Karula. She's heading into a very thick riverbed where she can now go and relax and start thinking about where she's going to get her next meal. And what we're going to do is we are now going to head over and use Carol's advice and try and catch up with those hyena before they get to the den sites. I know that James did confirm that that den site that used to be active a couple of weeks ago was in fact active again this morning, and it's been many, many weeks since we saw those hyena. So look forward to getting there, but it'll be a few minutes and we're going to send you back to Brent and the puff adder. Enjoy, they are such pretty snakes.
Look at that incredible, we can see the individual scales and that reptilian eye. And there's definitely a reason why there's that common phrase, reptilian stillness. I mean, it is not moving. It obviously is very well aware we're here, but it is assuming that we don't know it's there, relying on its camouflage. Are we staying probably about a meter or so away from the snake? Not getting too close, we don't want to disturb it. There you can see how well it camouflages amongst the leaf litter. But as I was saying before we went to go have a last look at Karula before she disappeared into the drainage line, They have fangs that are basically like hypodermic needles. So the inside of the fang is hollow, and it has got incredibly strong muscles around its venom sac. So where the venom is produced from the venom glands, and basically it's able to control how much venom is injected. So venom is obviously quite an important thing for a venomous snake, and quite an important commodity, so they don't want to waste it. So they have these muscles that enables them to control how much venom they inject. So if they something small, they'll inject a little bit less. If they're defending against a big potential predator, they'll obviously try and inject as much as possible. And that's really, really fascinating. And all the front fangs are so very thick, and their teeth are grooved. They actually really have to sort of chew on something to get that venom in there. Whether it's with the front fang snakes, adders, cobras, mambas, they're able to inject and control the amount of venom they're injecting. And also those sharp, sharp hypodermic needle-like teeth make it a very, very effective system for depositing venom. So a puff adder like this, its favorite foods are frogs and mice, and maybe sometimes lizards and even other snakes. But it is a definitely one of the apex predators of the snake world, and not much likes to mess with them. Occasionally wild animals do get bitten by them as well. Like it's possible that that Matimba male lion who got bitten by a snake who had that wound, it could have been something like a puff adder. So cytotoxic venom, it's cell-destroying venom, so it causes necrosis around the bite site. And as I said, quite a few people are bitten every year in Africa by puff adders. And if you do get to hospital in time, it is a very treatable thing. But you never know, and a lot of the people who are bitten very far from clinics and hospitals. Maybe not dying, but losing limbs, fingers, things like that. And that cytotoxic venom works very, very quickly. But really nice that he hasn't moved. And so let's have one really nice last close look at the snake before we continue on and see what else we can find out. That Barbara's a little bit worried about me because I walk around in sandals and we have snakes like this out here. Well, fortunately, Barbara, most snakes are far more scared of us than we are of them. And as I said, a puff adder will hiss and try to warn you not to stand on him before you stand on him. And I can guarantee you, everyone, whether you're wearing sandals or boots, when that hiss comes out of the long grass, you watch human beings leap high into the air in all directions. We were just talking about how the snake injects venom through those hypodermic needle-like teeth. And another little quick fact before we go on to that about the puff adder. It is the fastest striking snake in the world. It is one of the slowest moving, but its actual strike is one of the fastest in the world. And sacrosanct is saying she's heard that they never, or sometimes they don't inject any venom at all. And that is true. It's called a dry bite. And it's a warning bite. As I said, that venom's very precious to the snake and they don't want to waste it unless they really feel threatened in defense or for acquiring some food. So we're going to leave this lovely little puffy in its nice little nest here where it's not going to be disturbed too much by elephants and other animals under some logs. And we're going to go back to Scotty, who's got hyenas on the move.
We've managed to just catch up with the hyena again, and this does look like a female. I think I can see some nipples there, and she's heading in the general direction of where the den site is that James thinks is active. It's just up ahead on this road, so we're going to continue skirting along and seeing where this hyena goes. Quite thick and they move quite quickly, so it's going to be difficult to follow her off-road. But I think what we can is probably just head off in the general direction of the den sites and maybe just actually get there, see what's going on, and take it from there. She's already moved off too far into this thick bush at too high of a speed for us to follow her. But she could zigzag back and make her way back to the den. So not far from here at all. I am so happy that you guys got to see that puff adder with Brent. And it sounds like a wonderful sighting. You got some great close-up views. Not a nice snake to be bitten by, as I'm sure Brent has let you know, but an incredible snake to look at. And very jealous, but happy for you guys. Anyway, you are now going to be taken across to another section of Juma, and that is with James, and he's waiting at a waterhole for you.
Well, everybody, it sounds like the most action-packed morning imaginable out there, and certainly it's been very peaceful here, and lots of birds and interesting things at Biffle's Hook Dam. I'm so glad you got to see that snake as well. Now, those are not birds, of course, those are hippopotamus, but just behind them are two saddle-billed storks, which have been having a delightful breakfast of fish. They've been eating some fish, small fish. I'm just hesitating slightly. Tebs, if we swing to the left, on the bank of the river there are two pied kingfishers just bank of the dam wall there. Just zoom in. Yeah, exactly there. Just punch in there and I'll direct you up a bit, up a bit. Now punch in straight there, left, 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 left. There they are, middle of screen. Punch in there, left a bit, left there, down a bit. There they are. Now those two pied kingfishers, everybody, I think are probably looking for a nesting site, which is quite exciting. They will nest in mud holes if they can find them, and I'm sure that's what they're looking for over there. So they're quite nicely hidden there on the banks of this dam. Then we also have, and before we go out from there, let me try and find them first. Well, there's some woolly-necked storks on the top of the dam wall. And they're also enjoying the superior fishing conditions presented by this drying out dam. And there are quite a few of them. And then you'll be pleased to know, everybody, that our fairly suspect parents in the goslings, if we just go below them, there's one of the gosling goose parents, and the other is just above it with the four goslings. If you go to the left, Tebs, you can see the four goslings there with their other parents. Now, we did start off, of course, with eight, and I saw a little pair of geese yesterday on a dam on Biffle's Hook, and they had managed to raise seven of their clutch, and they were definitely keeping a lot closer to their goslings than these two seem to. So perhaps young and inexperienced parents, or perhaps just negligent. But either way, they've only got four left, and often when we come here, they're kind of fossicking about on their own, those little ones. And so I don't think that these two geese are necessarily the best parents at Juma. Now, Tebs, if you just go down a little bit from there, there we go, there's a little bird wading along the shore. If you go, that's him, well done, great. Now that indistinct bird will only be interesting, I suspect, to the ornithologists amongst you, or the twitchers. And that is a wood sandpiper, correctly identified by our various ornithological genius viewers, after I incorrectly identified it as a green sandpiper, which is a dreadful faux pas on my part, 3 days ago. But the wood sandpiper is still here. And then the other bird that we've got to show you, up in the top of that tree over there, is a grey heron. Not a particularly rare bird, but certainly nice to see them. There are two of them there. Those two black blobs there are the woolly-necked storks, but they're sitting with two grey herons. And those herons started off their morning when we arrived by singing to each other. Now, I don't know if you've ever heard a heron singing, but a heron singing sounds a little bit like a vehicle engine grinding to a halt as it seizes because of a lack of oil. That is what the song of a heron sounds like. It is deeply, deeply unattractive, and how they have been gathered together in the order of birds called the passerines or songbirds is a great travesty of justice to any bird like a robin. It should be grouped with a bird with such a foul voice, but they are still very interesting ones to watch here. Then, just above us, there's a whole lot more going on. And unfortunately, they seem to have absconded for the moment, but we can see their nests. The red-billed buffalo weavers are building frantically here. They've been bringing sticks in and out, recreating their huge nests. And these nests are remarkable, the speed at which they get developed and built. And let's go back now. Oh, this is marvelous news. All right, so Scott is back with the hyena den, and I think you can head across there and have a look and enjoy what's happening there. So nice that we found that again, and we'll keep you posted and see you just now.
So we've been waiting at the den for a couple of minutes. The one individual sleeping over there was here when we arrived, and another one has just returned. The one whose tail you can see wagging, moving around there. Just going to give it a moment or two, but let me actually reposition now. I think we're not in the best spot here, so just want to move us around onto the other side of the den. Although, let me just give it a moment or two, because we haven't been at this den for many weeks now. I'm not too sure which burrows are most active and whether there are any new additions to the clan. We could get surprised. There could be a tiny new black cub. There's three different females that have all been giving birth at different periods, which is interesting because often in hyena society, it's just the alpha female that will give birth. But here there's clearly three different litters. Well, there was at least last time we were here. The youngest of which was probably approaching 4 to 5 months of age when they moved the den site elsewhere, and that's why we lost track of where they were. I think it's safe for us to now reposition. Thought for a moment she may be coming across onto this side of the den. Shouldn't take us too long to get into another spot. It is very thick here though. There's a little pathway here where we can wiggle our way through. Perfect. And this could be the youngest cub. I think it is, but maybe I'm wrong. I'm not sure what you guys think. What will be able to help us work that out is earlier on in the leopard sighting, there was one hyena with a very distinct scar on her back, and I mentioned that I thought that that was the mother of the smallest cub in the clan. And I think this could be her. Maybe I'm wrong though. I can't see her back very clearly. But what we can see is that that cub is getting a serious bath this morning. Sheesh. And again, just like the tongue of the leopard, Karula, who was licking the meat off the bone earlier, this hyena has also got a very rough tongue that will help keep her as well as her cub clean. Well, Jeffrey in Texas, I'm equally as happy as you that we have relocated this den site, and well done to James for finding it earlier this morning, confirming that they were actually here. We had speculations that they could be here. Now, Jeffrey's brought up a great point and mentioned, could we not have used our drone to help find the hyena den? And I guess we could have, Jeffrey, but it does have to fly very low in order to be able to see clearly what's going on. It doesn't have the ability to zoom the camera on that drone. So I don't think it's probably the perfect tool. It could work, but because of it having to fly very low, it could chase off other animals, and it's something that we are trying our best not to interfere with nature and what's going on. So we wouldn't take the risk of just flying it around low level in a kind of grid pattern to try and find a den, especially because the likelihood of being able to see it, small animals like hyena and Vim, look at this. It's a tiny new cub. There's a new addition. Can you believe it? Cute. This is the first time anyone has ever seen this cub. So every single one of us are breaking history here. And I know it was just a glimpse, but that's good enough. Oh, here it comes again, Vim. It's minute. It could be in and around a week of age, between a week and 2 weeks. I wouldn't say too much more than that. They are born blind and helpless. But I mean, that is miniature, and it's come to drink from mommy. And the great news is it doesn't seem too concerned about us, which is a surprise because there's no ways that any other vehicle would have been here. Nobody else has seen that hyena. Oh, I think another hyena has arrived. There's a lot of audio that I'm hearing now. The little cub has just popped back out, but what I'm thinking of doing is repositioning the vehicle slightly. This will give a much better angle from where we are here. So this one hyena, the mother of the tiny cub, she's waiting at the entrance to the burrow there, and then there's another three hyena down to our left, two of which are big old females, and then another cub. Here comes the cub, here comes the cub. And it's squealing. This is awesome. We very seldom get to see this. Very interesting that she was sampling the nipples there. And interestingly enough, the same female hyena that arrived earlier on, the one with a bit of a scar on her back, did exactly the same thing. So obviously the taste of milk is still one that excites even adult hyena, because both of them came in and sampled the nipples of this young and immaculate female. It's remarkable to see what great condition she is in compared to the other two ladies around us here, who are much older and more war-torn and scarred than she is. I'm guessing it's not going to be too long before this little cub comes out again. It was just the initial excitement and greeting of that adult that... Oh, hear it squeal. I can hear it squealing again. It's desperate to come and have some more breakfast with its mother. Here it comes. Oh, I think it just tumbled back down the burrow. Keep watching closely. It's going to come out again. And while we wait here, I just would like to let you know that I can confirm that the hyena we saw earlier at the leopard kill was in fact the hyena with the scar on her back, which was... Oh, no ways. Still not quite comfortable with being out for long periods of time. The mother doesn't seem too concerned though. Spotted wood dove is calling in the tree directly above these hyena, so you'll be getting great audio of that. I can't see the bird, but it must be very close by. Kinds of stuff happening on safari this morning. Brent has now found another very interesting and venomous critter that he would like to show you. We'll be sure to race you back to see this little cub if it does pop out though.
Looking down and detritus of the wood. And we found a little scorpion. I'm just gonna, oh, did he escape? No. By checking under the logs, just move it a little bit further that way so you can get a nice view of him. So, okay, so a little bark scorpion. They do get quite a bit bigger than this, and they are just incredibly, incredibly beautiful little animals. They are very, very non-aggressive, these guys. So it's very seldom they will sting. And if you look at his, how big his pincers are in relation to his tail, and that tells you he hunts more by using his pincers than his venom. And so even if he was to sting you, this one probably wouldn't hurt very much at all, and possibly like a bee sting, or maybe even less than a bee sting, a little bark scorpion of this size. But incredible little creatures, and it's wonderful if you check around under that bark quite often. And incredibly, we're able to show you sensory movements. So this is one of the favorite things, and we're gonna leave him here. I'm gonna put him back under the little piece of branch I found. And you can see this is a dead bush willow here. So let's just pop him back. He doesn't like to be out in the open. It makes him a threat, or it's dangerous for him with birds and other things around. So, but really great that we're able to find all these tiny little things and show them to you. So we're going to leave him here. We're going to carry on, see what else we can find. And while we do that, I know, really exciting news. A new hyena den. But before we go back to that, James has also got something that's terrestrially based and something we only see during the wet season.
Look at this, everybody. I know that we've shown you the shells, but this giant land snail is just coming out to say hello. Look at that. Look. These are long-lived snails, apparently about 10 to 15 years, some of them. And there he comes. Just exactly on cue. Ooh, no, he saw, unfortunately, he saw me. Let's just sit for a little bit. We will take you back to the hyena cubs now, because I know a snail is not necessarily quite as exciting as a hyena cub. But just look at this, look at this. I'm going to sit very still. His eye. There comes his other eye. he's turning his mouth. He turned his mouth towards me. I obviously didn't like the cut of my jib, as it were. Let's see if he does one more. I don't know. We have been sat here with him for some time, trying to coax him out of his shell. That's it. Here he comes again. Little eye sticking out. Here we go. Now, I don't know if you're able to see there, but no, you won't be able to. But there's a little black dot on the end of that stalk on his eye. And he's turned his mouth towards me. Oh. There are all sorts of sensory organs pointing straight towards me. Mouth, what I think passes for some kind of a nose. Look at that. It's like he wants desperately to come out. Now, of course, in the snail world, nothing happens with any kind of speed. The tortoise, two tortoise species that we get here, make the snail really seem truly pedestrian. Here he comes. This is lovely. Isn't that amazing? Let's see if he'll actually move for us. There he goes. So you probably can't get an exact impression of his size, but he's about the size of my hand, basically. And you can see just behind him, he's leaving a trail of sand. And that sandy kind of covering is what they will use in the wet, dry season, to sort of cover up and shore up and make sure that they don't desiccate during the long, dry months that we have. But now we've had a bit of rain. They've come out of what is an aestivation, and imperceptibly almost, the land snail is now on the charge. Look at him go. He's doing about 4 inches per hour. So an interesting question about these snails here, and meningitis from deer or dire. Is it true that it's dangerous to touch snails because they carry meningitis? Deer, I haven't heard that before. I truly hope it is not true, because I did touch it, and I've touched many in my time. So perhaps in some parts of the world, dear, but I don't believe out here that meningitis is carried by the giant land snail. And indeed, certainly these are edible. I've never eaten one, but I know of people who have. And obviously an entire nation of French people eat snails with great regularity. So maybe there are some species of snails that carry meningitis, but I don't think these ones do. And dire, of course, the most famous disease-carrying snail is a small snail that occurs in some rivers in Africa, and they carry a disease called bilharzia. Oh, he's doing a 180-degree turn. This is the snail equivalent of a donut, or handbrake turn. You saw how he suddenly saw Tebs there and also disappeared into his shell briefly, but Tebs, being slightly kinder looking than me, obviously didn't make him go all the way back in. High action, everybody. Now, what an appropriate name for this high action sequence that's going on here. Adrenaline rush. That's precisely how I feel at the moment. I'm having a huge adrenaline rush from the speed at which the snail is executing his 180-degree turn. You want to know if it's got 4 eyes. As far as I know, it's only 2 eyes, and those 2 things sticking out the front are other sensory organs. I have to confess that I don't know a huge amount about these snails, and I need to go and do a bit of work reading up on them. A very good question from Kevin. What does the snail add to our ecosystem? Kevin, well, obviously it's a source of food for many things. The shell will be used by various animals to gain calcium. Tortoises will chew on the shells. Porcupines will probably chew on the shells. And probably various other animals. Lots of birds will like to eat these snails. But basically, snails, I think, are generally vegetarian eaters of various bits and pieces in detritus. I also think, if I'm not mistaken, these snails, if I'm not mistaken, and I might be, and you're welcome to tell me I'm talking nonsense here, I think they eat millipedes, if I'm not mistaken. So they're also quite voracious predators. You can see, moving at this kind of speed, there's not much that could possibly escape the attentions of a giant land snail. Right, I think possibly because we've had so much excitement here with the snail, we should head back to a calmer sighting of a, well, I think definitely less impressive animal in the spotted hyena, Crocuta crocuta, and we will, Tebs and I, take a deep breath, let our heart rates come down after the excitement of this giant land snail. So over to Scott, and we'll see you just now.
Well, from an adrenaline-pumping sighting with James to a slightly more relaxed one here at the hyena den with the new cub. It is tiny. It's been out just for a couple of minutes now. Just started suckling. And isn't it just adorable? I'm sure a lot of you are interested in its coloration. They are born pitch black. And my guess is that it's anywhere between a week and 2 weeks old. I could be well off that the right age, but I'm certainly no hyena aging expert, especially with young little cubs. But what I can tell you, like I said earlier, is that it would have been born blind and helpless, which it clearly is not now. It can move itself around, can see clearly, it's clearly conscious of us and giving us a once-over. It is in all likelihood the first time that it has ever seen humans and or a vehicle. And like most young animals, it's quite inquisitive as to what exactly we are doing here. Oh, what's Mom heard? Well, another thing that's interesting about this sighting is that it could well be the first time that this female hyena has given birth. It is just a speculation, but she does look young and in great condition. So, possibilities there that it's a new queen. And in hyena society, it is the females that are dominant. Not the males. So a queen is a more important title than that of a king. And even the lowest ranking female is ranked higher than the king of the clan. As we watch this little cub explore in and around the den sites, Derek is interested to know whether this is the same den as Big Cat Week last year. And no, Derek, it certainly isn't. This is one of the newest dens that we've seen them coming to. Oh, look at that. And it's about a mile away from the den that we were viewing the clan at this time last year. Oh, looks like this hyena, just like the other youngster we saw earlier, is also getting a bath. Mom's not very gentle with it, but you got to be tough out here, and only the fittest and strongest survive. And another question regarding the internal structure of the den has just come through from Gubawala. That's a name I haven't heard before. Good to have you on safari with us. And how many burrows and networks of chambers are there within there? I'm not too sure exactly, and I guess each den will be slightly different, Gugabala. But what I'm fairly certain of is that the little cub has got a few little networks and alleys that it is only big enough to get into, and you'll find the adult hyenas won't be able to probably move in there as easily and as readily as the young cub. Another thing is that it's not uncommon for a hyena to abandon dens and share dens with other animals like porcupine. So each den will be a little bit different. And I'm certainly not brave enough to stick my head down there and have a look at what's going on inside this specific one. This is an incredibly cute sighting. Now, Brent does have a surprise for you guys on Bushwalk, and I think we'll shoot you across to him now while the cub's out of view, and we'll get you back here as soon as possible after the surprise.
So, while we've been, we haven't even moved 30 meters from where we had that scorpion, and now it's time to do a little bit of safari CSI. It's taken us quite a while to work out what's been going on here. If we're gonna come have a look over here, you can see there's some diggings on the ground, and there's some very interesting, it almost looks like there's been a big tail over here. We can't see any distinct tracks. We can definitely see big claws that have been gouging out this digging here. And then we come over here. They're not digging too deep into the termite mound. There's another little digging over here. Again, it looks like a tail, but is it? So let's see if you guys can figure out what this is while we take you through the CSI of this, of these tracks as we move through. So remember, if you can figure out what it is, or you'd like to guess, send your questions at wildearth.tv on email, or use that Safari Live on Twitter. So we're going to stand by right. There's still quite a few more different things to look at, and in a playful mood.
So it is all happening on Safari Live this morning, which is great stuff, and I urge any new viewers to let us know you're watching for the first time. Send us through some questions and comments. Look at the little cub now. I think it's going to climb on top of its mom's head. Oh, just nibbling on her ear. This is awesome. Incredibly cute little animals, the baby hyena, and they do a great job in actually swaying people's perceptions of these animals, which have been painted in a bad light. And thanks to this bad publicity from various different shows or documentaries or movies, these little cubs are doing a great job in changing people's negative perspectives and outlooks on these animals. There's nothing wrong with hyena. They fit into the African ecosystem incredibly well, and they're integral for everything to run smoothly out here. Sadly, like I said, it's merely bad publicity that's given them, or given people a bad impression on these animals. Mainly that they are scavengers and that they steal from other animals, like leopard or lion. Which, don't get me wrong, is the truth. But leopard will steal from other leopard, they'll steal from their own kind, as will lion. And every animal out here will essentially negatively treat or bully other animals when they have the opportunity to. It always comes down to power. Oh, tumbled back down its burrow, rightfully so, after attacking its mom. That was awesome. So still learning a little bit about its kind of body and how best to work those paws. It looks like it's slipping. It's like it's on a treadmill. It's running on the spot there. It can't get enough purchase to get up. And I know Kay made a great observation earlier, and that is that this burrow is very steep and not easy for the cub to get out of, and you spot on, Kay, that little sequence we saw there was a great example of that. Literally running on the spot. Its little hyena claws aren't quite big enough to give it the required grip. Now, when this little hyena was less efficient at moving itself in its first few weeks of its life, Lyell in Washington would like to know if the adults would carry them around just like a dog or a cat would, and spot on, that's exactly how they would transport their cubs when need be. There's a crested Franklin that's alarm calling. And you wouldn't believe what's happened here is that this is not the only home for hyena, but it's also a home for birds. Wium in the tree, dead tree. If you go to the first fork there, yeah, just zoom straight in there. And if we just wait there, we will see a red-billed oxpecker, which has just headed into that cavity that you can see in the center of the screen. And if we just wait a few seconds, I'm sure it's going to pop out again. I'm not sure if it was coming back with food that it's going to feed to young chicks or possibly nesting material. Wonderful stuff though. The hyenas have their den on the ground, their red-billed oxpeckers and the tree directly above. And that's the great thing about spending prolonged periods of time in one given spot. Then if you just pan up to the right a little bit, I can see the oxpecker's head. It may have come out of a different cavity. It was just poking out behind that branch, and what there may be is different entrances and exits to their nest. It's an old knobthorn tree, it looks like, and there could be multiple chambers or cavities which lead to the main nest cavity. Oh, there it is, Vim, it's just popped up there. There we go. So great to know, and we'll have to, oh, and another one's just popped up below it. So a happy couple. They do form monogamous pairs. And let's see if it doesn't go into this cavity now. I think they could be either looking for a nest. Oh, there they both go. So that's what I saw disappear initially. The shrill call there of the oxpecker. Bright yellow eyes and that big red beak, designed for plucking off ticks from a lot of the different herbivores. Oh, there's another adult. Difficult to tell who's male and who's female here. They both look the same. Crested Franklin still calling in the background. Great, well that's where the nest is. Be sure to let the other presenters know when they're spending time here at this den site. And now back to the cub. Here is definitely going to be the new and upcoming star of Safari Life for the coming weeks. It's going to have some competition though, with lots of baby impala around in the future. Brent saw the first baby impala yesterday afternoon. I've yet to see one. And who knows, maybe we'll get to see not only this baby hyena, but also a baby impala later on. Hello to Adrenaline Rush, and you've asked a good question wondering whether eagles will ever try and catch little animals like this, small hyena cubs, small leopard cubs. And yes, definitely, if this little hyena was to venture out of the den without any adults here and an eagle was to see it, most certainly it is well within the size range of a lot of the eagles in this area. And it's important to know that you even get eagles big enough to take down small antelope. The martial eagle predates a lot on bigger prey than this. Also, kind of baby impalas are well in the bracket of being catchable for those large eagles. So it certainly could happen and does happen from time to time. Another thing that eats young cubs, especially ones that live in burrows, are pythons, the African rock python. So that's another thing that could happen. We're going to rush you back to Brent on the bushwalk now. Enjoy.
So we're at the next set of diggings, and you can see that something's really got those really sharp claws. And Doug, we've had quite a few guesses to what that this possibly might be. Some people are saying aardvark and anteater, but it's not. Now there's another little clue, a very little clue. And we've seen before that new incredibly sharp sting there. So that is another little clue down there, and that has come out. So whatever's been digging these holes has been after scorpions, and we can see just the remnants of a sting left here. This part wasn't eaten. And you can actually see this dangling bit, if I squeeze it, white. So that's where the venom's come from. Fortunately, I don't have any open wounds on my hand, so it's okay. And so this animal has been feeding off scorpions, and there's literally diggings all around us with little bits of scorpions left. And very well done to Carol, who got it correct. This is a honey badger digging. And honey badger has been actively hunting scorpions, and very successfully. We found about six different diggings where they've successfully pulled scorpions out. This one just forgot a little bit of the scorpion. Here we go. So well done, guys. We're going to keep moving on. We actually haven't got very far today. There's been so much to see in the short place. The ground is littered with news of what happened over the evening. So while we continue to move on, we're going to go see what the... Oh, we're going to try to stay with us for a little bit. And as you can see, here we go, there's the next set of diggings. And I did see a pincer here. There we go. So while this honey badger has been running through here, he's been gobbling up so fast, he's been leaving bits behind. And these all look really, really similar species that they're digging out here. And I know just behind us, we're going to try to get to the next set of diggings. There's apparently... Oh, there's four or five diggings where each has left pieces of scorpion everywhere. But isn't this incredible? If you look closely, you see a lot more stuff. And that's the wonderful thing about the walking safari, is you are really, really connected to the earth. Here we go. Here's the next set of diggings. I mean, if we come have a look here quickly at this hole, you can see how deep these scorpion holes really are. And the honey badger's got those really, really hard claws. I mean, if I take my stick here, the honey badger out, ground surface of the ground would be. So, I mean, that's probably a foot. We're looking for little bits of scorpion that have been left. Oh, look at this. he forgot most of the scorpion. No, he ate the whole abdomen, but he didn't eat the head or the pincers. So with all the pieces left behind here, he could probably make up a whole scorpion exoskeleton. Very, very cool. This is a really big scorpion for this particular species. So a really great meal for the honey badger. Okay, we're not going to take this with. We're going to leave this here because other insects and animals will still feed on it. Oh, imagine that. So last night on the sunset safari, we saw an emergence of alets or termites. So the drones and queens of the termites, and this is what happens to them after they fly off. They lose their wing and they then try to find another mate, and they'll run around on the ground. This is where they're very vulnerable to being eaten by scorpions. Scorpions are really big fans of eating these guys, as well as lions, leopards, hyenas, will all eat flying ants. Such a rich protein source. And in a lot of parts of Africa, people eat them as well. So from a tiny little flying ant to the biggest animal in the bush.
Right, everybody, come down to the southern end. We've had a wonderful morning and it's just getting better. Two young bulls moving stealthily, as elephants are able to do, to the north. Just in here, we'll just get a quick view and then I'll move around and try and get a bit closer to them. There they go. And you'll be able to hear the birds, but I bet you won't be able to hear those two elephants walking through. They seem to be moving in a pretty steady manner. They're stopping for the odd bite to eat, and then they just keep going. I don't know where they're heading to. Perhaps gently towards a source of water that they know of. Let's go around the other side of them. Lovely block of land in this area here. Lovely marula crest. Marula trees on top, a couple of bush willows below, and lots for hungry bull elephants to eat. I'd put them probably at about 20 years each. Harass them, so one of them's getting a little upset. He doesn't like the noise the car's making. So what we'll do is we'll just go around the other side of him. So rather than go up behind them, which will probably make them feel uneasy, we'll go up next to them. They're definitely moving kind of with a purpose. I don't know why they wouldn't be feeding now. It's kind of a good feeding time for elephants. Just up ahead here. Now, I don't know, we're not going to harass them. If they start to move too quickly away from us, we'll leave them and we'll see if we can't find some others. The young bulls will be quite nervous. They're not yet in their kind of prime. They're not yet in their, they don't have the confidence of adults, if you like. There we go, there's a decent-ish view of one of them. You can see they're watching us very carefully.
And another wonderful Twitter handle name. Dank Duck. You might be a new viewer, which is just wonderful to hear from you. I definitely haven't spoken to you before, so welcome and lovely to hear from you. Dank Duck, you want to know, you saw a puff adder with Brent earlier on, a cytotoxic snake. Would it affect an elephant? I don't believe that it would, Dank Duck. I think it would probably give it a kind of, maybe the effect of a bee sting, but that's only if the puff adder actually managed to get its fangs into the elephant's skin. Now, an elephant's skin is probably about that thick, and a puff adder's fangs are probably about that long. So the chances of them actually envenomating an elephant would be extremely small. Apart from the fact that the snake would obviously try and move away from the elephant, Dank Duck, I really think it's highly unlikely that they would be affected by a puff adder bite. These chaps are just not very happy to be seeing us at the moment. Alright, so I think we're going to leave these chaps. Let's go back to the hyena den with Scott and enjoy that. What a wonderful thing that is to find a new pup cub there. We'll see you just now.
Well, as you can see, the mother hyena's up. I'm not sure what's got her attention. The little cub is down in the burrow below her. She's standing just above the entrance to it. And what's not uncommon is for hyena adults to move away from den sites during the day, in the middle of the day, even when cubs are small, and that's in order to be able to get some rest and relaxation for themselves. I guess no difference to humans. There's stages where you need to put the kids away to sleep and to relax without being able to pester you for more food, and the hyena are the same. So it could be that this hyena is getting ready to move off. We did see it nurse the little cub for a little bit earlier on, and maybe she wants to go now and rest, relax, recharge the batteries. Not far away, maybe 40 or 50 meters away, she'll just lie under a bush. So she's close enough to respond to anything strange that may be happening here, but also far enough away from the cubs to get some peace. But I was wrong. Looks like she's not going anywhere. She's getting comfortable basically in the same spot where we saw her this morning. So she doesn't want to leave her cub just yet. Well, on the topic of nursing little cubs, Katrina is thinking about the future of this little cub and what will its mother do in order to bring it more solid food as it becomes older. Good question, Katrina. And hyena have got quite an interesting kind of scenario when it comes to feeding on solids and also being weaned off milk compared to other predators. And what happens is that hyenas do not regurgitate their food. I've never seen that happening, and that's something that wild dogs will do, Katrina. They will run off from the den many, many kilometers away in search of food, and they'll often actually leave one or two adults behind as babysitters, and the pack that will then return with bellies full of meat that they then regurgitate for not only the pups but also the adults that got left behind. What hyena will do sometimes, I guess similar to wild dogs to a degree, is bring back meat to the den. But even that doesn't happen as regularly as you would think, which leaves you wondering, well then what do young hyenas' cubs do for food? And they rely heavily on milk. So they nurse for much longer, up to a year and sometimes even longer than that. Whereas regular kind of, well, lions and leopards, at least regular predators, what am I saying? Lions and leopards will, from about 3 months of age, start being taken from their den sites, wherever they may be, out to kills that either the pride or, in the leopard's case, the individual mother has made. So from 3 months of age, lions and leopards will start feeding on meat and being weaned off milk. And from about 6 months of age, you'll probably find lions and leopards not drinking much milk at all. Whereas with hyenas, very, very different. They will rely heavily on milk up to even a year of age. And when you think about it, Katrina, it does make sense, because leopards are elusive and have the ability to climb up trees and therefore evade kind of danger, especially for the cubs. It makes sense that they can take their cubs to kills, which are dangerous areas. For lions, they've got the defense of the pride, so they can also take their cubs into these dangerous areas to feed on protein, on the meat. Whereas hyenas, they're not really in a situation where they're big enough, strong enough, they can't climb trees, and they do rely a lot in this area, but it varies on where you are in Africa. They do rely a lot on scavenging, so on dangerous scenarios, dealing with lion and leopard. So you wouldn't want to take a young hyena cub into any of these highly dangerous scenes. You'd rather only take them there when they're about a year of age, they're a bit bigger, they can defend for themselves and run a lot faster. So those are the reasons why hyena are considerably different to the other predators of this area. Good question though, and it's going to be interesting to monitor the progress of this little cub. And I guess the great thing about it is that there are some slightly older cubs that we will see getting exposed to more wild things, more dangerous things, like being taken to leopard kills and lion kills to try and scavenge. We're gonna stay here, but send you off to what sounds like an absolutely astonishing little insect.
Look at the colors on this creature. Isn't that absolutely magnificent? That wonderful, wonderful red and that sort of gold plating. This is called a burnet. It is a daylight moth. And there is two main species of daylight moths we find here, a burnet and a forester. The burnet has got this wonderful golden red coloration, and the forester is sort of royal blue and yellow. But they are incredible, incredibly little things. And it's amazing with this camera, we can even see the little hairs on its head, and that color must look absolutely spectacular to these guys. I mean, you're getting the exact same view as me. I'm lying down eye level, looking at every little minute detail, the compound eye. And the reason I can tell that this is a moth is if we look at the antennae. So it looks like they're solid like a butterfly's, but they're not. They're actually feathered. So they're tiny little feathers, and that's what distinguishes it as a moth. And they are beautiful. Also, it seems they're just a little bit more furry and a little bit more fat than most butterflies. And in this cool morning, the wind's still around, there's still some dew, so they're still all resting on the stalks. There's actually quite a few of them around us. This just happens to be the best looking of them, the least bedraggled. And with these bright colors that they possess, it's what you call aposematic coloring. It's warning all predators that it's potentially very unpleasant to eat. And so they have a very labored and slow flying style. And you can see the proboscis is probably curled up. I can't really see it from where I am. Oh, there we go. And that proboscis will open up and they'll go and feed and use that proboscis to dip into the different flowers to feed on the nectar. And obviously in doing that, they collect pollen and move it around and pollinate the other species. One of their favorites is the weeping wattle, and you often find them in great numbers on those trees. And this morning's been spectacular. We've hardly moved, and that's the wonderful thing about the rains. It brings out all sorts of wonderful creatures, and creatures you quite often don't see from the vehicle. Isn't that absolutely gorgeous? I could literally lie here and see and watch it all day. I think they're probably only going to get moving in an hour or so once the sort of dew's worn off the grass, and go in search of flowers to feed on. Okay, well, isn't this been spectacular? We're going to keep going, and hopefully we don't have to move too far before we find another creature. But before we do that, it's got these bright colors that generally lends towards it being noxious or unpleasant to eat, poisonous even. And Katrina's wondering that. Katrina, if I remember correctly, they are not poisonous. They rely on these colors as a form of mimicry to confuse birds and other things that they are poisonous. And that's why they have that low, slow, labored flying style. It's to make sure everyone can see their bright colors. But still, these guys, sort of late morning risers, they're not up with the crack of dawn. Let's wait for the sun to come out and dry the earth a little bit. Well, let's leave this little guy to wait, and we're gonna carry on and see what else we can find. So we're gonna stay with us for a little bit and let's see what else is about here. We're walking along this very interesting area. It's a transfer zone between soil types. Up towards the top of the ridge, we've got sort of much more sandy granite soils. Where we are here, we can tell by the different trees we've got here, we're on a duplex soil. What that means is we've got sand on top of clay. So the water table in these areas is a bit higher, so you get more grass and less trees. Oh, I was speaking about, let's just have a quick walk down here. There's a whole bunch of those weeping wattles that I said those moths really like to feed on. I did see one flowering yesterday. I think I spot some flowers. So that's possibly why they're all in this area. So we're gonna head down here. I can see some flowers. They're not in full bloom just yet. It'll be a little while before we get lots and lots of flowers on these weeping wattles, but they attract a plethora of insects. Here we go. Oh my goodness. Look at that. Everywhere we go today. Look at that spot. Oh, he jumped. He escaped. I got him. Oh, he went up. Where'd he go? There was... Oh, there he is. I'm going to try to get him in my hand. Now look. Look at that. It is a crab spider that is the exact same color as the flowers. So I'm just trying to, he's on the move. And isn't that incredible? So he or she will hang in that flower and wait for the different insects to come feed off the nectar and lie in ambush. And this is the first time I've ever seen a crab spider like this in a weeping wattle. And look at that, exact match for the color of the flower. I'm gonna try, it doesn't move. There we go. Look, it's looking like it's getting ready to jump to try get back to the tree. And, oh, it's obviously not that comfortable. It's busy bungee jumping at the moment. So before we stress the poor little guy out too much, oh, it's actually attached a web to the camera. I'm gonna put him back in the tree next to a flower, and then we'll look at another flower. There we go. Look at that. Isn't that absolutely spectacular? So, here we go. We've got the flower that, as I move towards the flower, and you can see how that spider matches the flower's colors perfectly. So I was about to say that these flowers attract so many different types of insects, different types of flies and bees and butterflies and moths. And where there's a lot of prey species to eat, you'll find a predator. And I mean, we talk about how amazing a leopard's camouflage is, but I don't think a leopard's got anything on that little canary yellow crab spider. Wow, I'm actually at loss. It's the first time I've actually seen one that matches the coloration so perfect. I'm just at a loss of words. I think I'm gonna have to check every single weeping wattle flower now to see if I can find another one. And maybe we should definitely start looking a bit more carefully at all the other flowers, because there might be different types of crab spiders. Maybe we can find a blood red one next time. As I said, that's probably why we found those moths very close to here, because they have one of their favorite food species, the weeping wattle here. So we are gonna carry on a little bit. And you can see it's just weeping wattles. Oh, maybe we'll find something else. There's a weeping wattle and a lot more flower. And we do, oh, it's not stopping. The bugs are out in force today. Look at that jewel beetle. Look at how pretty that jewel beetle is. And another crab spider. And we'll look at the jewel beetle first. This is one thing I do truly love about the summer months. We have so many different awesome insects to view. And obviously you can see why that beetle is called a jewel beetle. It has beautiful colors. I've actually seen a jewelry designer in Johannesburg who bases her jewels off these beetles. And she has brooches that are exact replicas of the beetles. And then, Jean-Ré, just look at the spider. Slightly different colored, not quite as yellow as the other one. So I wonder whether that's a different species. In the middle, crawling through, coming around. Oh, they jumped. There, another crab spider. Look at that. And you can, on the tip of that, there he is. Oh, where'd he go? Coming back up. And believe it or not, mating weevils in the background. About to crawl. Oh, they jumped away. Unbelievable. And we haven't even seen a bee yet. And you can see the flowers haven't quite all opened yet. And this is the thing that really excites me. I'm definitely going to have to get into my insect book and my spider books and do some serious research. I think it's possible we might even find some species that none of us here on the Safari Live team have ever seen before. So I think let's do one more check of the next set of flowers. And so, talking about these crab spiders, Anna-Marie's got a very, very interesting question. She's wondering, do they actually change color to match where they are? Anna-Marie, I think they would have evolved probably alongside these plants. So each crab spider that's of a different color will evolve to a particular flower or a particular plant. And it's incredible. There's a lot of jewel beetles actually on here when we start looking. I'm not seeing anything we haven't seen before. There's another jewel beetle there. Let's try get the jewel beetle in the sunshine. It looks like the sun was about to break through the cloud for a second. Oh, where's he gone? I can't see him. But there's... Oh, there's another one up here. Oh, there's another two, three up here. Try be gentle. There's one right in the flowers feeding on the pollen. Where's he gone? He jumped. Oh, look at that. That's incredible. He jumped from that great height and landed on a stalk of grass without falling. I'm gonna just pick him up. I will put him back so you can have a really good look at him. Absolutely exquisite colors. I mean, you've got to think that artists and whatnot, painters must have got so much inspiration from insects and their different color forms. I mean, look at that orange. It almost looks like a racing car orange. Sorry, he's just moving around. Let's try to get you to have a quick look at his face before he disappears. Look at that. Oh, he's looking for something to climb onto. Shame. Let's put him back on the bush. He'll be much happier. Here we go. Oh, there's two of them on that leaf. So now that we've had a sort of second decent rain, we are going to be getting a lot more insects. And also, I'm very excited to see quite a few of the wasps that come to these flowers. So wasps are also important pollinators of different tree species. But isn't that incredible? Everywhere we look this morning after this rain, there's new life in the insect world. I'm gonna test Jandre a bit. Sorry, Jandre, I know this is gonna be quite a tough one to catch, being mobile. But there's a little robber fly. There's a couple of them around here. I'm gonna try. They're flying a little bit, but they're not flying too far. And you can see, the way they move, and sorry, that was, I know it's really difficult, but the way they move and the way they're shaped, they actually mimic bees as a sort of defense mechanism. So from the really small camouflage to the much larger camouflaged with James.
Look at that, everyone. What a incredible stroke of luck this is. That's shadow, as far as I can tell. And so, well, certainly what I've been told. Daughter of Karula. 9 years old. So I think Karula's first youngster. And what a privilege. We're so close to where Karula was last seen. It's absolutely astonishing. And their territories are right next door to each other, of course, but they seem to be overlapping more and more as the days go on now. And I think it's got to do with the fact that neither of them are pregnant at the moment. They're not needing to defend territory from each other. Big hole here, lots of thick bush, but she is moving, so I'm afraid it's going to be fairly intermittent. But how very special to be seeing her now, today. After we've had Karula for 5 days, her daughter is returned, the prodigal daughter. Our aerial is at an alarming angle at the back there, so if you see me looking back, looking afraid. Now this is fascinating. We can see her marking territory there on that tree. It's exactly what Karula was doing in precisely this area about 4 days ago. So this is definitely, the territorial boundary is clearly just through here. Now I say not pregnant. She is looking very heavy-bellied indeed. That might just be because she's had a good breakfast or supper last night. Or it could be that she's carrying a baby. Watch out here, Tibbs. Nasty thorns. Tibbs, can you see her? Oh, there she is. She's over there in front of us. So, yeah, it's a pretty thick bush. So, watching both these ladies mating with the same male, Tingana, and Anna Marie, you want to know if Karula is pregnant? Well, if she isn't, there's definitely a problem, because she's now mated with Tingana 3 or 4 times, and so has Shadow. So if Karula isn't pregnant, there's definitely an issue with either Tingana or Karula. If Shadow, I'm not sure. She's looking very heavy-bellied to me, though. But that said, it wasn't 3 months ago that she was mating. Oh, look at that. Wasn't 3 months ago that she was mating, so I don't think that can be a baby in there. It wasn't very long ago, but you can see she's limping. You see that limp there? She's favoring the left, at least the right forepaw, i.e. the right front paw. Definitely a bit of an issue there. It could be anywhere on the limb. It could be in the paw, it could be up in the shoulder. Doesn't look too bad. It's certainly something she'll have to watch out for. Remember that leopards just can't afford to be injured because they are solitary. Not bad scavengers though. Oh, there we go. Yes, I agree with you completely. What a drive, what incredible action we've had. Not with even the incredible land snail. I mean,
The adrenaline rush from that land snail was quite astonishing. Right, she's gone. There she is.
Put her there. There she is. Just under there. Marking territory. Spraying urine. And we're coming out onto a bit of a clearing now. Oh, no, she's gone. Just look at that. You can hardly see her in there, everybody. I can just see her. She's sat on her haunches and she's kind of clawing and scratching at that jackalberry tree. Oh, that's wonderful. This is so special. What a drive, as you say, Ria. Two leopards, mother and daughter, hyenas everywhere, scorpions, puff adders, giant land snails in full charge. Nice road up ahead, so any luck to walk on. You see her, Tebs?
Yeah.
There she is. Oop. Not there. She's coming out now into the glorious sunlight. She is still marking, smelling. Ah, look at that, as the sun catches her. Just perfect. Let's wait and see what she does. Now, she, of course, is Karula's daughter, but one of the interesting characteristics she has, which her mother doesn't have, is that she favors termite mounds enormously. She loves to go and sit on a termite mound and have a look about what's going on. And she's also not very good at hoisting. She doesn't like to hoist her prey very often, unlike her mother. So they really, you can tell the different personalities. Yeah, you can see the panting. I think she's eaten something. I think she's had a very substantial meal last night. But you can see a definite limp there on the right forepaw. Oh, look at that. How spectacular. Let's just go a little bit closer. Slightly different angle. Now, to my mind, and I know this is going to offend some of you, I'm very sorry for what I'm going to say. I think that the princess of Juma, if Karula is the queen, I think the princess is a more beautiful example of leopardhood. She's just got that more golden colour. Lovely shadow. That's a substantial limp. Paul Rizzo, absolutely correct you are. For a full family reunion, we need Quarantine and Kunyuma. Now, for those of you who don't know, those are two of Karula's, I think three or four litters along. They're siblings to Shadow, two young males who are about to enjoy their third birthday in December, as far as I'm aware. And you can hear the crowned lapwings, very upset. They've probably got a nest around here. And they'll bomb Karula, they'll bomb her, at least the shadow, if she gets in there, gets too close. But she's heading now due west. This is pretty typical now. So she's on the western fringes of her territory, and at least eastern fringes. So she's heading west now, back towards Arethusa. Here she comes. Look at that. And you were watching Karula today. Try and notice the difference in their faces. I know many of you will be very familiar with the two of them, and you can identify them probably from a single spot on the hind leg. But for those of you who are perhaps less familiar, just try and notice the differences. For me, this is a slightly larger leopard. She's got a slightly longer face. She's definitely a little more gold.
her spot pattern, of course, is very different as well. And the spot pattern is the unique spotting that each leopard has just above the whiskers. This is just fantastic. I mean, I can't believe our luck today. I'm sure you're all sitting there for breakfast. Well, hopefully not. Keep breathing. Keep taking deep breaths. Keep the heart rate down. Going to go probably into some thick stuff here, and that's a brilliant observation from Barbara. Barbara, I think you're absolutely correct. You can see the tail there up flicking. There it is, flicking away, and that white tail tip, quite apart from being only a following mechanism for the cubs, seems to indicate to birds that might be alarm calling on her that she doesn't pose a threat. And often she'll stick that tail tip up when she's not hunting. And what you heard there, Ted? She'll stick a tail, the tail tip up, and the birds will then stop alarm calling at her. Right, we're heading towards the what is called the triple M break, or the boundary with Arethusa. Here she comes. Now there's a Franklin alarm calling here. You can hear it going, bleep. It just did a few very half-hearted alarms, and I'm sure that's got to do with the position of the tail, as Barbara has suggested. I've got myself totally disorientated now. She's actually heading due north. She's not heading towards the power lines. At least the triple M brake, sorry. But here we go, there she is. And I'll just go through here. You can hear, but there's a Franklin going pachow, pachow, pachow. There you can hear. You can hear the pachow, pachow. There. And the other birds, you can hear the magpie shrikes. There we go. Oh, going to sleep. All right, let's try and reposition so that we can get a nice view of her. So those other birds, you can hear a delightful sound. The magpie shrikes. That aerial does look like it's not long for this world. Quite amazingly, and despite all evidence to the contrary and engineering logic, Wendy's signal seems to have improved with her aerial facing 90 degrees. Tell me when it's good for you, Ted. They're fine. No? Yeah. Lovely. And silly sticks are in the way. If I had a long... So let's stay here with Karula. As long as our signal is fine, we will deal with the fact that our aerial is listing heavily to starboard. And just enjoy spending some time with magnificent shadow. I'm so happy to see her today, I must say. I was feeling very left out with my giant land snail, while Scott was with leopards and hyena. Brent was with puff adders, but now we're with shadow. Now an interesting question from Lisa, and I think it's a valid one. Could it be that Karula is paler because she's older? Yes, they do tend to get paler as they get older, a bit like us humans, Lisa. So that could definitely be a difference. That said, also like us humans, leopards just have different colored hair. And certainly if you've ever seen Quatila, who comes from a long line of golden leopards that started with the Sunset Bend female up at down at Londolozi, they are sort of exponentially golder than any other leopards that I've ever seen. And so yes, absolutely, they will get paler as they get older, but they do vary as well. So perhaps Shadow will look the same as Karula when she's that age. Remember, they're actually not that far apart. I mean, Karula is, I think, pushing 12, and old Shadow here is 9. So I'm pretty sure that Shadow was Karula's first cub. And if she wasn't, well, I mean, she must have been. If those ages are accurate, then she must be her first cub. So she's not a youngster anymore, old Shadow. She's certainly not old, but she's not a youngster. So she will also have faded slightly, and I don't mean that in a derogatory term. Her coat would have faded slightly. You can see that tail is still up and twitching from side to side. And the Franklin is still giving a half-hearted call. Now, what happens with these leopards when they become territorial is that the females will set up a territory next to their mothers normally. And obviously that means that there will be territorial shifts, and one territory will have to become smaller than it once was, perhaps. And so Virginia and Kentucky, the fact that they have a territory next to each other does mean that they will meet up from time to time. I haven't seen it happen myself, but I think certainly some of our viewers have seen it, and they will recognize each other. There will be a very familiar smell about it, and I think you'll find that the meetings will be totally unaggressive. There might be a little bit of hissing and snarling sometimes, but otherwise they'll be fairly amiable meetings that they have. Very special to be spending time with her. I think it's hilarious also. There's that Franklin you won't even hear it. It's giving a very half-hearted kind of alarm call. And every time it gives a little chirp, she just twitches her tail a little bit more and it shuts up. In fact, there's one, I can see a Franklin. Right, well, let's go across to the bushwalk where there are going to be some new babies fairly soon.
So unfortunately, this fruit chafer is no longer making babies. The male dismounted and vanished, but we still have the female here. We are standing next to a white berry bush, and the smell that is coming off this tree is incredible. Can you imagine the fanciest perfume shop in Paris and times it by 10? It is an absolutely incredibly sweet smell, similar to jasmine, but not quite the same. And also, you see these little flowers, little green flowers, and with these flowers coming out, all sorts of insects are attracted. So here we've got a little fruit chafer, and we've got quite a few other fruit chafers on this. I'm just going to try find one for you. There we go.
One on my lens.
Oh, Jandre has got a very, very cool longhorn beetle. This is going to be fun. Let me get a grass stalk to get the longhorn out of there. Come here, Mr. Longhorn. It's escaping. There we go. Let's just try get you out of the lens. There we go. So there we go. He's going to be moving. Look at that longhorn beetle, and incredibly beautiful colors. I mean, there's such a huge amount of different types of longhorn beetles, from a little guy like this to one that is the size of my palm. And they feed off nectar at this age, but when they lay their eggs in dead wood, and they are what are quite often called wood borers, the larvae. So they will bore and feed off dead wood. But they are really, really pretty. So let's put him back and have a look what else this white berry bush has got to offer. There's three different species of fruit chafer on here at the moment. There you go. We've got some speckled fruit chafers over here, getting really stuck into the nectar. And obviously, you can see why they're called a speckled fruit chafer. Beautiful little white spots. So, fruit chafers are something all you gardeners will know very, very well. I know my grandmother has been battling with them for about 60 years. They are very fond of eating roses, and my grandmother is very fond of roses. I'm personally more fond of fruit chafers, so we're going to keep heading out, seeing what else we can find. And while we carry on, we've got some oxpeckers building their nest.
So we've had quite a lot of avian activity here at the hyena den. These red-billed oxpeckers are the same pair that were investigating a cavity in this dead tree earlier on. And what we've noticed is that they've been bringing nesting material. Lots of pieces of grass and plugging it into this little hole. And I'm sure it won't be long before they return with another beak full of grass and other vegetable matter that they'll be lining the cavity of this tree with. A nice soft cushion for the nest. We'll be sure to race you back up there as soon as they return from the ground where they're collecting the grass from. We sadly can't see them from here, I can just hear them. But we can see the hyena mother. The mother of the tiny new cub, the new addition to the hyena clan here at Juma. She's been patiently sleeping here the whole morning. There's been no sign of the cub again, or even the older cub, both of which went down the same burrow. One cub's probably around 5 months of age now, roughly, possibly even a bit more than that. Oh, the birds are back, Wium. There we go, look, you can see the nesting material. Awesome, that was a long piece of grass. The other one now popped in behind. Sadly, they dropped a few pieces as they went in, but both husband and wife hard at work. Not sure who's who, as I said earlier. You can actually still see one blade of grass sticking up along the left-hand side of the entrance to that burrow, or cavity rather. And is this one going to take it back down? Or is it going to take it up? No. It's doing some housekeeping, rearranging some of their new furniture. Now, interestingly enough, while you've been enjoying a host of wonderful sightings with Shadow, with a whole load of different bugs and insects with Brent, there was two other birds that came in and checked out this cavity in the tree. They were greater blue-eared starlings. And VM quite funnily mentioned that obviously the apartment is up for sale and various potential buyers are coming to have a look. And essentially that is what's happening. It's not for sale, but it is up on offer, and birds will compete quite ferociously amongst one another for good nesting sites. So we could see a battle ensue between these oxpeckers and the greater blue-eared starlings. They were here at different times. And when the starlings were here, there was no sign of the oxpeckers. The oxpeckers probably have no idea that there are some other potentially interested couples looking quite intently at this nest. Well, you wouldn't believe this, but a small piece of nest material actually blew down from the nest cavity and landed on the hood of the car. And I'm holding it here in my hands. I watched it waft down, and can you believe that? I'm not going to keep you here much longer though, because the oxpecker did just, oh sorry Vim, the oxpecker did just land back up on the tree with another mouthful of vegetation, but just little bits of grass and leaves. And the oxpecker, like I say, is just up in the tree, or did it fly off? I saw it come back with a whole big mouthful of dead grass and leaves, but I think it may have either flown off or disappeared down the hole quickly. Well, this has kind of been the story of this morning. I was panicking as to what to do, race you back to the oxbeck or show you the little tuft of vegetation in my fingers. And it's been throughout the morning that all of us haven't known where to point the camera. Poor old Tara directing the show hasn't known which camera feed to take you to. It's been non-stop action and an absolutely wonderful morning. So I'm so happy that you guys have got to cash in on a wonderful morning. For those of you who were not with us on the earlier stages of this morning, what we can do is show you a very brief highlight though of the little hyena cub. And it's not something we often do. Usually you either see it live or you don't, but with special sightings like this, the reveal of this tiny little black ball of fur, we kind of bend the rules and we'll be very happy to show that to you a little bit later. So that's something to look forward to. But for now, we can just take a closer look at the mother. And hello to Sabrina in Texas, who's one of our new viewers. And very good to have you on safari with us, Sabrina. And I am very happy to let you know a little bit more about the complex social structure within a clan of hyena. It is a society that is ruled by females, which in nature, and I guess in Africa, it's not hugely common that that is the case. It's usually the men that are biggest and most dominant over the females. But hyenas, like I say, are different. The females are bigger than the men